know they look bigger on TV, don't they? Huh? So I don't have one of these yet. I gotta make that still. One of them, yeah. So you can get your MP3 out of sticking out of there, you know. So I got one sitting right here. Yeah. So you can get one of these nuggets sticking out of there. Which really, it's probably right there anyway. Yeah. And so I don't know. Will I fix that? I just don't know. Will I fix that down? I'll have to get into my. How much of that will I have to get into? At least 2 or 3 treads. Is that a problem? Not really. So there I go. Thanks for watching, you guys. Okay, so I decided that I was going to take more off than the 265 diameter that I was going to need because I want to try to get that, you know, a righteous looking number 10 on left over when I get done. Not that I cut all the way into the one or all the way up to one side of it. Yeah, not that it matters, but hey, you know what I'm saying? It almost looks like you planned it out. So I'll clean this stuff up and we'll get ready to drill some holes. And then after that, we'll do some threading.
Yeah, hang out.
One thing to think about that nobody ever talks about when they talk about drilling big holes from the tailstock is the fact that there's only a tiny little keyway in there holding the tailstock spindle from turning. So really, the tailstock, while it is okay for drilling, it's better for just running centers and stuff. And yeah, you can drill from here, but it's not, you know. I think my milling machine, it's got a 2-horse motor on it, but it's only rated for a 3/4-inch drill bit. Now that's not to say that I haven't had the 1¼-inch frickin', you know, the 1¼-inch pigtail in there, because I have. But you know, in this Logan, you only got a little keyway that's in there that keeps the spindle from turning. In my little mini lathe, that's only a little tiny drive pin. So just some food to think about next time you're drilling holes in something with your little mini lathe there. Think about the fact that if that keyway breaks off while you're drilling in a hole, there's a good possibility that it's going to spin that tailstock spindle inside the tailstock housing, and you are going to do some damage. Listen. Right through to the other side with it. We're going. Oi. There it is. Yeah. Wow, now there's a corkscrew, ain't it? There's our corkscrew. Oh, yeah. How would I do with my little sweeper?
Yeah.
Oh, man. Oh, dang it, Batman. What did I do with my sweeper? Get out of here. No dragon. No rubbing. Don't rub it unless you mean it. Oh, cat. Is that the... I hope so. I guess it's getting about time. I better figure out what the map all is on this show. I know I can't open that hole up past the major ID of the thread on the spindle. Yeah, right. The minor ID of the thread on the spindle. Yeah. Gets a little confusing saying it upside down and backward when you're talking about the inside of a hole. Okay, you guys, so after some bookwork and some math and some hunting, I believe the internal diameter on a 2¼-8, the minor, is 2 inches, 1/4-7. And I am in the neighborhood here of 2 inches, 1/10. And I may come out a little more, or I may not, depending on the surface finish. But honestly, going a little extra deeper with the thread tool, once I'm all lined up and going on in there, is not really going to bother me. It is hot. It's not a time-orientated thing. And we will be checking it with an actual spindle. And so when it fits, then it's good. Obviously, we know that the shoulder... finishes in at on the spindle at just in under 2¼, 2 inches, 2¼-8½, or whatever I measured that spindle at. And like I've said in the past, measuring anything under, let me turn the radio off. Measuring anything under a half a thousand with homeowner tools is likely going to be in the neighborhood of the fudge factor. And so, yeah, I can read a half a thousand, but when you start doing that, you're talking about feel in this direction, feel in that direction. If you're using snap gauges or whatever, or even if you have a, you know, if you had a direct reading bore gauge that was of quality, and it was inspected by a tool guy to certify, verify that it was actually right, then you could be splitting the tenths. But with homeowner tools, when you get below a thousand, and in the neighborhood of a half a thousand, if you're within tenths, then you gotta fit your pot from there if you want it to be nearing exact. And I'm just saying that because, I mean, it don't take but a couple of degrees or have your micrometer in your hand too long, and next thing you know, you're off by a couple of tenths. So while that certainly isn't gonna matter in here, jeepers creepers, ain't it nice to be able to do that kind of stuff? So I believe what the deal is here is I'm gonna just measure this again. And I'm pretty, where the hell did I just went with that tool? I'm pretty well good. You're probably not seeing that on there, but I got 2 inches, 111 and a half, or 11 plus a little, not quite 12. So guys that think that, you know, while you're not supposed to use this tool to be getting numbers that accurate, depends what they'll tell you. This was calibrated once upon a time, and I do have my own blocks to check stuff. But once you get used to it, you end up knowing. So I could pretty much verify that if I got that in that hole, yeah, if I pull out on it really hard, which you're not supposed to do because now you're cocking the jaws. But I'm at 2 inch, 112. And so, yeah, I think that I am going to make the shoulder now down to the 250. Because this is just a spindle protector. And any amount of run out in there, which will end up being negligible at this point, doesn't really matter to the part because it's not an accuracy thing. It's not meant for mounting any parts, tools, or anything. If you're going to mount anything in the spindle, you do it with the internal taper and the adapter that goes in there, which I believe Logan still supplies that adapter if you need one. They're not cheap, but it has an MT3 corresponding, you know, Moss tape up for tooling, which also fits my mini big dog. So I'll bring it to the MT3s and 2s. That's why, you know, I got MT2 over here. I got MT2 in little big dog. I got MT2 in drill press. Perfect. MT3 in this headstock, MT3 in that stock. Custom Miller's R8s. And, yeah, that to me is good. So, yeah, I could probably get an R8 with an MT2 taper in it, but it's just not really necessary because I already made an adapter. I got a Jacobs headstock chuck. What the hell was that? Inch and a half? Eight, I believe it was inch and a half eight. I don't even remember. I don't even remember. Where the hell is it? Here we go. Like it says on there, it's a Jacobs 55B. And this is a nice chuck. Nice chuck. And it is. It's inch and a half. It's 1 inch 8. So I took a grade 8 bolt and made me a nugget for it so that I could get up in an R8 spindle. So, yeah. So that's that, and I'll bring it back in a second when I figure out whether or not we're going to be, I don't believe that over-tight is a problem, because you just send the tool some more. And of course, the shoulder that's going to go in here, I'm going to measure that again. I believe on the back plate for the other chuck, I made that in the neighborhood just under 400, but it probably don't need to be that deep, because once it locks up against the spindle, it's all done. We'll take a measurement there and see what I got and make it just a little bit further in so there is no problem with threads, running out of room in there. It shouldn't, but that will be in the neighborhood of a 2 inch and a quarter, 2.25 recess in this edge here to lock up against the spindle when it's all done. And the rest is threaded, and then we finish the other side if I feel like it. After the fact. So, yeah. Try to have a coffee and bring you back. Okay, you guys. So, I have decided a couple of things about this thing. I am at 1 inch, 119,000. Which is... about 30,000 total undersize. And I believe that the reason why the math is like it is, and it, if you were to look up a thread depth chart on this chart, I believe it's in the neighborhood of 62 and a half. I could be wrong on that. Don't hold me to it. Look that up for yourself. However, there is a factor when it comes to specifications on, UNC threads. And it has to do with, there's all kinds of they give you areas of thread and all kinds of strength issues. So if you were making a fitting that the reason why the numbers vary, and that's the case, that's why. It has to do with the part is being made for, and those numbers will correlate to how much flat bottom or flat top you have at the crests or roots of the thread. And that, let me just simplify that a little bit, so that if I say that the crests and the roots are more pointy than flat, that would, you know, by all intents and purposes, make the thread or the part weaker, because it's closer to being a stress point where a fracture could occur in between the threads at the root of either the outside or inside diameter, depending on what you're making. And so I believe that's what has why the numbers can vary in this deal. So you'll have to get your own measurements and numbers depending on if you want to make one of these. Obviously, strength is not the issue. It's basically a cover for the threads to keep them from getting beat by chuckies or whatever. In case you happen to be running a collet system in your machine, or who knows, some of the bigger machines I used to run, we used to run chip pokers, a big bar to pull some of the stainless stragglers out of there. You know what I mean? And if it grabbed on nothing, you just let it go. But I believe that's what the issue is, and that's why I'm having a bit of a time figuring out whether I want the how tight to make the hole. If it really is 2.147, then that takes a lot of the thread out of the hole, and my charts are not giving me an engagement, a percent of engagement on that. So I am going to just set up a threading tool and start threading here at 120 and keep going until my spindle goes in. And the reason I'm doing that is because if I make the shoulder now, I got to change the tool. I could probably make that shoulder with this tool. But if I make the shoulder now, of course, I can't get to it because I don't have any threads, so I can't check it. If I make the threads first, at least I can check the threads before I carve the shoulder. And so that's what we're going to do. It would save me from breaking down and setting up again just in case there's an issue. So, yeah, I'm going to set up a threading tool.